So I'm really interested in hearing this panel. I'm going to just say a few brief remarks generally about youth climate action and a few more about YouCAN in particular, and then we'll get to the real speakers we're here to hear. So I have some bad news and some good news. The bad news probably most of you guys know, which is that we're again last year we broke the record for the world's hottest year. Each month this year we've broke the record for the hottest month on record. The news about the glacier melt, the rising sea level, ocean acidification, it's all bad. We've blown past 400 parts per million in CO2 in our atmosphere, and we have a real crisis on our hands. We find ourselves face to face with the greatest challenge that humanity's ever faced, and we're not getting much help from our national or international leaders. And when I talk here, and I'm talking to the youngest generation, when I say that you all didn't cause this climate crisis, but your generation is going to be the one that's most affected by it. And that really sucks. It's not fair. Okay, now the good news. You're not alone. You might be the most affected and the least supported, but you're not alone. Across the world, your peers are standing up. They're organizing rallies. They're educating their classmates, their parents, their teachers. They're launching campaigns to usher in renewable energies. They're spurring divestment movements. They're making music. They're planting trees. They're writing blogs. They're filing lawsuits, and they're changing local laws. Tonight, when you hear the story of local action here, from those on the panel, I want you to know that there's similar stories popping up around the world. Most of these stories are organic youth-led movements that are disparate standalone actions, but collectively they amount to a citizen-led global movement where everyone has one and only one shared goal. That's the recovery of our climate. So while we listen to the panel, I want you to think about how the panel's successes are your successes, and your successes are connected to all the successes that came before you and will come after yours. All our efforts are just one small piece in a longer story about how we recover this planet. And more broadly, I want us to recognize that if our existence is dependent on the health of our planet, and our planet's health is dependent on maintaining a delicate symbiotic balance between our natural resources and all living forms, then the connection between every living organism on this planet has never been stronger or more important than it is today. I think about the great power in that connection. It's the kind of power that can not only save the world, but in the process, change the world. And we're seeing it already. Communities and even countries across the world are making commitments to end their reliance on fossil fuel. And it's your generation that eventually will bring an end to our fossil fuel addiction. It's your generation that will create for your children a healthy, just, and sustainable planet. But you have to act, and you have to act now. Forces out of your control have left you no choice but to take control. To take control of your mind and body, your local government, its laws and policies. To take control of your life and your destiny. There's a certain freedom that comes with having only one path to survival. Your choice becomes not whether you should speak out, but how you should speak out. In answering this question, let me suggest this. Follow your passion. Your engagement in this movement should stimulate, connect, reward, and empower you. And that power comes in all different forms of empathetic expression. The movement needs it all. We need artists. We need caregivers, educators. We need those that can protest and organize. At our Children's Trust, we support youth who want their voices heard by their elected officials. We support youth who use local, state, federal, administrative, legislative, and judicial processes as a means to change or enforce laws. Laws that, when followed, will end this crisis and ensure a healthy, sustainable planet in accordance with the best available science. At OCT, we do not settle for progress's sake. We advocate for solutions, not political compromises. Lately, we've had a few successes, some key successes. I know that several of you here were down in Eugene in March for the hearing in the federal case, talking about the landmark federal constitutional case where 21 brave youth have stood up and sued their federal government. Now, at this hearing, the U.S. federal government and the big oil associations that intervened on their behalf together tried to kick the youth out of court. They tried to stop the court from hearing the youth's requests for an order that would require the government to implement a national recovery plan. They deny that the government has a duty under the public trust doctrine to ensure that our essential natural resources are preserved from this generation to the next. But we believe that this generation has a right, a constitutional right to a healthy and sustainable planet. That right's guaranteed under the constitutional right to life, liberty, and property. I'm happy to say that the judge didn't buy it. The case goes on, and we're on our way to trial. Now, since that magistrate judge's recent decision in the federal case, we've had two separate groups on opposite sides of the country succeed in state court. Courts in both Washington and Massachusetts have ordered state agencies to develop and implement science-based recovery plans. Now, critical as these legal actions are, the courtroom isn't for everyone. Local government is accessible, often even welcoming. It's run by leaders within the community, real people who care about the residents they serve. Community voices are regularly heard at weekly public forums. 2 years ago, Eugene became the first city in the country to adopt a science-based climate recovery ordinance. The ordinance was a product of a hard-fought, youth-led grassroots campaign coordinated by the YouCAN program. The ordinance legally binds the city of Eugene to produce a 350 carbon budget. It binds it to make its internal city operations carbon neutral by the year 2020. And cut city and community fuel usage in half by the year 2030. The ordinance only came about after a year-long campaign run by youth that included writing letters to the editor, painting murals, canvassing neighborhoods for community and business support, and most importantly, by showing up every city council meeting and testifying before their leaders, demanding this. The YouCAN campaign in Eugene allowed the youth to invest in their futures, to connect with their city, to gain self-confidence and feel empowered. All of these skills have gone, the youth have applied all these skills broadly since then, at home, in school, and in their community. And we have a YouCAN Corvallis now. It's happening right here in this town. The same folks that put on this great event tonight are going to lead the charge there, but they need youth that are passionate and dedicated and adults that are going to support them. They need help from all corners of the community. There's a role for everyone in this YouCAN movement. So if your answer to the how will I speak out question is by making sure my community does its part, please seek out Deborah, Sierra, Aaron, or email me or any of us. Get involved right here in your community. Thank you for coming out. Really excited about this panel and the question and answer time afterwards.